born in San Jose, California, 1926, and ended up with my mother and father. Mother was from Oregon. Mother and father got divorced. I ended up in Oregon, Eastern Oregon, LeGrand, and out in the country, and where we kind of lived on a farm, and basically all we had was the radio.
And how old were you then when you moved to Oregon?
Oh, must have been about 6 years old.
So your childhood was ultimately really spent in Oregon, it
sounds
like.
Yes, yes, very much so.
You know, in our kind of a rural time like that in the 20s and the 30s, what did kids do for fun in the summers? And, you know, it sounds like an outdoor childhood. I mean, what did you do?
Well, it ended up in LeGrand, which is about Grand Round Valley in eastern Oregon. It's about 3,500 feet, and the snow doesn't really get off in those days now. Now it's better, but in those days, the snow wasn't off till about May. So when the flowers started blooming, kids would get out in like a day and roll in the grass and really do that. We skied, did a lot of fishing in different streams, and ice skating during the wintertime, and just basically worked. Most of us did some type of chores to make a little bit. And
Did the Depression affect your family?
Yes, because we basically, in LeGrand, you either had a job or you didn't, and they had the ended up having Mount Emily Lumber Company, which is certain people owned, and everybody else in town kind of compared themselves to them, and we were poor. Poor in the sense that we didn't have any income. We weren't on charity. We didn't have old age pension. We didn't have Social Security. So the kids would go out and hawk beer bottles for about 5 cents a piece to buy my hunting shells, and I did a lot of .22 shooting. Squirrels and different things like that. And we would grow most of our supplies, and then we would trade milk, say from the ranch, for bananas from the grocer. We just kind of like trade. And I always tell this story, and every Christmas I'd get an orange. And so with my grandkids, I used to take that orange and eat the skin and all. They'd look at me. It was be in my stocking at Christmas. And I've tried to explain to them at that time in Oregon, to get an orange, you had to drive hard rubber tires, old trucks, from California, Orange Place, up the two-lane highway to eastern Oregon, and it took days, and it was expensive. So that orange was a great thing for us to have. But we kept busy. We didn't have time to really get in trouble, except Halloween, things like that. But it was a...
What was your school like?
Well, I went to, I had a teacher in Central School in LeGrand. Her name was Mrs. Meany, actually Mrs. Meany. But luckily we had an Andrew Carnegie Library. And my dad introduced me. He was kind of a cowboy. He was on the, about the third Oklahoma run. And he was kind of a cowboy type when he ended up out in Oregon, Idaho. So he introduced me to a library, and I spent an awful lot of my time reading books. And today I read about 4 or 5 books a day, and about 85% comprehension, in the sense that I could step in that book, and I could remember, I think it was Stowaway in Paradise, a cup of Halley's, and a Hawaiian kid stowed away in his ship out of San Francisco to go to Hawaiian Island. I could step right in that boat and go with him. And I'd stay with him, so I read a lot.
You know, when you look back on your childhood, even though it was hard years in the sense that it was the Depression, did you like your childhood?
I thought when I first, until I was about 35 years old, I thought that we were poor, and because I always compared myself to the people across the street who were millionaires, owned the lumber company in those days. And so as a young child, I thought I was poor, but I found out later on I wasn't. All the rest of us were poor. They were just the only rich people in town. And my grandmother was and grandfather more or less were from Oklahoma and Missouri, Dakota City, Nebraska, that my grandfather was born in, one of them. And so they were real southern type, dyed in the wool, had evolved from the south up to these countries, and So they had their ideas were, well, golly, I haven't seen you for days. I thought you'd gone over the hill and the hogs had ate you. That sort of thing. So it was kind of a interesting thing. But the reading and all the schooling, the Andrew Carnegie Volunteer Library we had there, kind of put me apart from them because they didn't read. I mean, they read, but very little. They thought I was weird.
But it does sound like a wonderful childhood.
Oh, yeah, it was good. Yeah. I did all the sports. My dad was a professional boxer. I boxed, wrestled, high school, and the football stuff, and grammar school, and softball. So we did everything, but we kept busy.
What was your situation when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
At that time, my mother had, I don't know how much you would need into this, but had remarried. And my stepdad's a wonderful person, but they had my sister 2 years older, my brother 2 years younger, and myself. So it was kind of hard with a new stepfather. So my sister and myself, which were the oldest two, went to live with my father in California. And I can remember December 7th, I was out there playing basketball in Redwood City, the high school grounds, when Pearl Harbor happened. So,
do you remember what did you have any reaction to it at that
madder
point?
Than hell. Madder than hell. Anybody would do that to us.
We'll talk about then the situation under which you got into the Army Air Corps.
I had at this time we were playing basketball. I was only 16 years old, and I decided, by golly, I want to get in the Air Force. And in the high school paper, my sister wrote the journalism class, and she wrote the paper, and I said that I wanted to be a pilot and a captain in the Army Air Corps, and that's exactly what I ended up many years later, but of course. So at that time, I put in for Navy V-12 program at Stanford. I put in for the aviation cadets. And I put in for Merchant Marine Officer Candidate School at Hunters Point, I think it was, below San Francisco. So I had three things going.
Why were you all fired up to get in?
That was my country. That was my country, and nobody's going to do that to us. And, of course, hindsight, you have to look back and say also we only heard one side of it, too. So we didn't really have a lot of propaganda like the TV and stuff like we have today. So you kind of had to believe what they told you.
So you had these things out there. What happened next?
Well, actually, the aviation cadets. I had moved to Sacramento and went to Sacramento High School there. And I had put in for cadets, and this had came in first. Took my test and everything, and they called me up. And I left in about 1944. I got out of Sacramento High, even though I'd put in 43. And so I went to cadets, went to Presidio Monterey, then up to Buckley Field, Colorado, in aviation cadets. And they had classification. And at that time, they had so many students per instructor, they didn't need that many pilots. They had way too many. So they raised the standards, and out of my class about 1,500, 15 passed under the new standard, which I did. But I went to gunnery school, armament in Lowry Field, Colorado, in Denver. And I finished there and went to Las Vegas, Nevada, and started shooting, which I'd done a lot of shooting, hunting and all this sort of thing before that.
Were you actually in the gunnery training using like shotguns and things like that?
Yes,
shooting skeet?
It was really fantastic because I'd shot birds. And of course, not that many shells because they gave me many of them, but it's some of the best world-class instructors. Robert Stack, the movie actor, of course, I shot international skeet later years trying out the Olympics with him. So it was kind of a connection, but started my shooting career, but we went there to Las Vegas. At that time, it was nothing but they had the Rancho Vegas on the strip, and that was it. And then they had taken bulldozed the soil, sand away, and all the soil was white. And so it was about 125 off the ground. It was horrible to go in there. So I went there for about 6, 7, 8 weeks, gunnery school, and I shot skeet every day with shotguns, 12 gauge. And then they had a, they used to have a, one of the things they ran, they had a road, was shaped like the old style basketball keyhole. And so you'd go down this road and that keyhole would go around like this, the road would, and because you're in a B-17, later on a gunner, you'd be shooting out of the waist, and they'd have the first bird. You'd be back of this pickup going 35 miles an hour, 16 stations around that loop, and you'd have this bird coming straight at you. And, of course, you're going this way. You had to shoot behind it like you would the B-17, part of your gunnery training. And you'd go around that handheld Model 12 Winchester and shoot those things. And
you know, preparing for war is a serious business, but still, as a young kid with a shotgun and shooting skeet, it must have been fun.
Oh, it's fantastic. Mm. Fantastic. Oh, I'm going over there. I wasn't scared yet, but it was coming. Yeah.
So you got the gunnery training, then where did it go from there?
Well, they sent us all out. We didn't have a crew. So they sent us all to Ardmore, Oklahoma, which is that those days was OTU. And I think we went there and we did gunnery and we had B-17 low-level flying over Gene Autry's old ranch. They had his ranch there and they had these wood targets. And instead of driving in a pickup and shooting these clay birds coming this way, we'd drive along in an airplane about 1,000 feet and shoot wood targets off to the side. Well, he had his cattle there. And so we'd kill his cattle most of the time. So we always got, Gene Autry, we always got in trouble down in Oklahoma.
So after you were done.
And we got together with our crew. Our crew came together there.
What was that like? I mean, you have these strangers coming together and, you know, you. Did everyone coalesce pretty well, or?
Well, it's kind of like the old days. All the money in the we always figured in the West the money was all in the East. And I had a pilot from more or less from Illinois. The co-pilot was from Connecticut. The engineer was from Ottumwa, Iowa. Radio operator was from Blue Sulphur Springs, Virginia, someplace way back in the boonies. And then we had other waste gunner was from Kannapolis, North Carolina. So mostly Easterners. Well, here we are Westerners, and we're entirely different people in those days because all we had was radios. So we didn't have TV to see how they lived. So it wasn't quite easy at first because you always had the ones that came from the big city were just a little hard, and us folk out in the West were nice folks, you know.
Which gunnery position did you have?
Well, I worked out of the ball turret for a while until I gained a little weight, got bigger. I was growing. I was still a young kid. And I was youngest, by the way, on the crew.
How old were you?
19 when I had my first mission. This time I was only 18. And I was still growing. And so when they put you in a ball turret, you little bunny shoots. Heated suit you wore had little wires in it and they short out. And so then you'd have to wear that heavy leather stuff with sheepskin lining with the big boots. Well, I've got size 13 shoe and I could never even run the pedals in the ball turret, so they put me up in the waist and put a smaller man in there. And it worked out a little better.
Who was your pilot?
Sloan.
Do you remember the first name?
Walter J. Sloan. He got killed about 1952 in Kansas someplace driving. And
okay, so you've got the face training, the crew trains together. Did anything odd, unusual, anything stand out in your mind as far as that crew training period, or even really the entire training period, anything kind of unusual happen that you remember?
Well, I don't want to get into politics, but we used to go down to Dallas, the Dallas Hotel. And in Oklahoma, if you know, that was dry. You had to have your booze in the bar, and you paid for your booze, and they handed it to you. You couldn't bring it in. And we used to go down to Dallas and get a few extra bottles and come across the border, and the sheriff of the county would always seem to meet us. And the guy down in Dallas would tell him, the sheriff, that we were coming. And so that was about the most exciting thing yet during those days. But it was interesting, though, that we actually had gone from Arden, Oklahoma, our crew, we went to Lincoln, Nebraska to kind of get together, and then that we were going to go overseas from Lincoln, Nebraska. It happened over Christmas, and they gave most of my leave you wanted to while I was from Oregon. And that was a long way from home for me. And at that time, we really hadn't gelled enough so that they would want to take me home with them, or I'd want to take them home with me. So I stayed at Lincoln, and snow on the ground, and Christmas time. And I remember coming back from town, and you look at that basin was just empty, hardly even any tracks in the snow. And it was quite, I think at that time, I finally realized that I was probably growing up. And we were going someplace. We were in Lincoln, Nebraska after the Christmas, came back, and we went by train to Boston, Massachusetts, and went up there, and they had a Camp Miles Standish, I think it was, in Boston. Went up to Camp Miles Standish, and they had the Isle de France, the French liner like the Queen Mary, which we finally got as our ship, and I think we called it the Eisenhower. Later on, it burned. Anyway, but we went up to Boston, and we loaded that ship on Christmas Eve, just after Christmas Eve, before New Year's. And I can remember being up there at Boston, and here's all these society gals getting their pictures taken. Snowing, we're standing there waiting to load on this ship. Well, on this ship was about 7,000 infantry people that had really goofed up all during 4 or 5 years, and they just loaded them on this airplane. We had one...
On an airplane? Or?
Loaded it on this ship. And we had one Air Force career, and we had no place for us. So they put us in the brig. And it was wonderful because we had nobody around us. We didn't have to sleep in these bunks like these guys when they were drunk, sick, really bad. In Isle de France, we went by ourselves, like the Queen Mary. Took us about 8.5 days across the Atlantic. And, of course, everybody get up on deck and try to get the air. And food was stewed, kippered herring and stewed tomatoes for breakfast. And just about killed us, you know. So we finally ended up on this trip roughly 8.5 days later. Well, actually back at Boston, all the society gals, Red Cross, would get their picture taken, and here would come the Salvation Army gals and give us our donuts, stay out there all night with us. So I liked the Salvation Army folks. But we got over to England, Glasgow, and went into there. But we unloaded, went to Stone, England, which on the train, and I can remember so well going in that train. It was cold. I was wearing long pants, heavy clothes, and little kids were wearing shorts, and these little knee socks. And hey, gum chum. I say, oh boy, you got any gum? You know, you can't miss it, and all that sort of stuff. And so we would throw in our candy bars and all this stuff on the train as we were going to Stone, England, which was our replacement depot. Well, by this time, this is 1945 January. It's, you know, time's been going by. And so we arrived in England, went to Stone, and replacement depot, and then all of a sudden they called us up, and we came to Framlingham, 390th. And I can remember so well when we walked in, because January 14th, 1945, they lost 9 crews. So we walked in. The barracks still had all the people's clothes in it, the personal gear.
That was the Durban mission.
The Durban mission, you're exactly right. Yeah. And it was such a shock. You know, you walk in, well, where do we sleep? Well, you just take that bed. Well, we got the clothes here. And then it finally said, bling, it's not fun anymore. Mm. And it was kind of hard.
Did the training continue in
your
way?
Oh, yes, much so. We had missions, but we didn't have a lot. I think it's because they lost all those airplanes. And we only had a couple missions, I think, and I flew my first mission, let's see, the 14th, and my birthday was the 16th. And I was 19 years old, just a couple days after that.
Let me ask you a couple of questions about what was the base like there at Framlingham? Where did you live? And
well, it was kind of nice because I was raised in farm country in eastern Oregon, wheat farm, different things like that. But we never had land army girls harvesting our grain. And you see those girls out in the middle of the runway, what the hell are they doing? You know, it really dawned, it was really unusual to have them just part of the country. And I guess that was the hardest thing, that our airfield wasn't separate and wasn't completely fenced. We had people wandering through the middle of it, and it was get into, but it's hard because we got into the barracks and Quonset huts, I guess you'd call them, and they had those two little charcoal burners.
How did you stay warm?
We didn't. We still, well, I'm not going to say that either. We would go out and get any kind of wood we could find, but if you remember, it belonged to the queen. Any of the land belonged to wood. You couldn't go out and cut it. We'd go out and maybe poach a little quail or pheasant, but it all belonged to the queen. If you did that, they'd throw you in jail. It was. But it's the funniest thing is those little stoves and that charcoal rations, and I really learned one thing there. My bread today, when I toast it, I want it burnt, because I burn it on those little stoves that were red hot for a period of time. But I froze to death. It was pretty.
And so, did you ever get into town, into Parham, or into London at any time while you were there?
Yeah.
What was the R&R like? The getaways.
Well, it was pretty interesting. I'd always wanted to go there, after a few weeks, we got a pass more or less to go into London, and I went by myself because I'm basically not a drinker, and some of the people like to drink more than I did, and so I wanted to see things because all these things I'd read in these books all these years, I wanted to go there, and of course a name like Burnham, well, it kind of wanted me to find the old English people over in England, so I went into town, went in Ipswich, I guess it was, and took the train and the junction and got to London. Had a wonderful time the weekend, went to the, if I remember right, there, right down in Piccadilly Circus, there was a Chinese restaurant. And right by the Windmill Theater. The Windmill had the Chinese restaurant, the Windmill Theater was kind of back in here. The Regent Palace was over across the square. And that was the only place I could find a place to get enough food. Because it was all vegetables, and it cost me $1 or something like that at that time. But so I went there, had a wonderful time, got the train to come back and everything. Lo and behold, got in Ipswich, and I didn't know how to get home. There was no road signs. They'd taken all the road signs down. I had no idea. So I figured I could walk it. And, I get a hitchhiker ride from somebody, and I end up someplace and end up here. Finally, they got me the right place anyway. But it was quite interesting, and I spent some of my time. I played, got into golf a little bit. And I'd take my bicycle and go to all those little golf clubs around the country, around the base.
How did you relate with the British people?
Well, what was it? 7th Army was still gone, and well, I think it was the 7th Army was down in Africa. Had been away for about 5 or 7 years, maybe. And the families and everything were there. And there had been a little trouble in the sense that, not trouble, but crossing up of some of the wives of their people with our people. And they weren't very happy. So you could, in 45 I'm talking about, you could really get in some tough situations with some of the English people. But I was always kind of lucky because with a name like Burnham, being an old English name, they kind of would leave me alone a little bit. And I didn't get real loud in pubs and places like that.
How many missions did you fly?
I think it was about 20. And then the war was over. Well, the armistice and the food drops and the war was over.
And do you remember your first mission? I mean, I just wonder if there was some anticipation and that kind of thing.
Well, I think it was Royan, the little rail junction one. I think it was a long time ago. But it was been bombed so damn hard. It was more, you know, like one of our training missions, anything else. And it didn't really dawn on us, except when we saw the damage at the rail yard and everything, that little town. And we saw the damage, but it didn't really dawn on us that that was like war. It looked like a field. Didn't look like a town was completely flattened or something like that. So it didn't make too much effect. I think the hardest thing was when the RAF would come home. We'd take off. You remember in the mornings, and the RAF airplanes would come home right across the field. No electronic stuff at all. They'd come home. And it was pretty rough flying. That's the thing that scared us the most.
That is a potential for collision.
Collision, yes, yeah. Sir. Yeah.
You know, you're obviously not going to remember all 20 missions, but there has to be some missions that kind of stand out in your mind for one reason or another. What are some of the memories that of memorable missions that you might have?
Well, I'm talking 1945, and it wasn't that every mission we'd even see a fighter. We'd see the contrails, maybe the fighters all gathering, and then you'd see the F-51s contrails come up there after them. And I can remember one mission, I can't remember which one, up beside us, a 262 jet came up beside them. Everybody shot at them. You could see a little bit of the skin of the wing kind of crinkle up, but nobody knocked him down. He just did a split S and went on down. And that was, you know, things like that. But we went to Berlin. And let me
ask you one question. By the way, just so I'm clear, I know you mentioned you were in the ball at one point during training, but then did you end up as a waist gunner?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Okay. And did it seem odd to see a German jet, I mean, to see an airplane without a propeller in that era?
Yeah, it did quite a bit. But we had gone down to pick up an airplane at Birmingham or someplace, England, and we heard this horrendous noise, audacious noise, and I couldn't figure what the hell was that. And it was a Comet with the back of the fuselage off, and they were running up the engine, a jet. That was a British jet. And so we weren't then, we'd seen this, we thought, aha, that must be a jet. And so then when we saw this one, it wasn't quite the surprise that you would get if you never heard them or never even thought about them, and all of a sudden they were there.
Did the German jets seem unusually fast as far as trying to get a bead on them?
Not really, because they could stand off with their guns, they'd come in the front or the back or wherever, down below us, so you didn't have really any great closing angles. It was just straight on. Well, of course, when you get a whole bunch of them coming straight on at you, well, then they'd go through you so quick. You're going a couple hundred, they're going 400 or something like that. The closing speed then is rough, but with the computing sights, you never, the waist guns, you thought about it, but in the waist gun, it was angled. It was, so you didn't really think about tracking them. You got out ahead of them, 3 Brad deflection, whatever. That you never worried about the closing speed of them.
Tell us about the Berlin missions.
Well, we went to Berlin, if I remember right, when they briefed us, that they said that we were going to bomb the rail station. And I think the whole Air Force bombed the rail station, because I think their troops and everything was heading south to Dresden, down to Bavarian Alps, and they're going to fight to the death. This is just things that are wagging. And they went in there, and we found out later, I think, what did we do? We had 85,000 people was in the rail depot, something like that. And that sort of thing really stuck me. But it was interesting with the fighters, because the F-51s at that time could go all the way to Berlin, protect us, and then they could drop down. Half of them dropped down and hit all the German fighters. landing and refueling or taking off from their bases. And they lost a lot of aces right there. So we were always happy to see those guys go down there and go after them.
Did you ever have flak damage on your missions?
Well, a couple times we had with flaps and inner flaps, we'd have holes, stuff like that, and nothing real herdaceous, stuff like that. Although one time we lost 2 engines, and we were talking, oh, let's go to Sweden, you know, like everybody. But towards the end of the war, we said, heck, we can make it home. We made it home okay. So.
And that's an interesting point is, you know, would the B-17 fly with 2 of its 4 engines out? I mean, were you able to stay with the group?
No.
So you were on your own.
At this time of 45, it wasn't too bad, but I imagine in the earlier days, you were in trouble. You were in bad trouble. Because once you fell behind, they just knocked the hell out of you. And if I can remember right, you guys were always telling us to get that formation tighter. Get in there. So to try to fly a good formation. But that guy fell out. He was in trouble in the old days. But in 45, it wasn't, you know, the lines were fairly close. And so it wasn't that big a deal then.
Did you have to lighten the aircraft when those engines went out?
Well, we'd already shot up a bit of our stuff. Yes, but we did get rid of a few things.
Were there any other missions that you can think of that stand out in your mind for one reason or another?
Like, remember, I think one of the missions towards the end, we went down to Munich. And outside of Munich, if I can remember there, we were about 12,000 feet maybe, and they had the airfields. We were hitting the airfields, and I can remember the airfield just outside of Munich that they had hangars with airplanes sitting in them, and we were going somewhere to bomb, and we weren't necessarily hitting these airfields, but I could see the F-51s coming in and strafing. The planes were sitting back underneath these in these hangars, and it was kind of interesting about that time there, too.
Were you involved in the Chowhound, the Feeding the Dutch People missions?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, it was kind of a weird deal in the sense that I don't know if you saw the food. They had 10-in-1 ration and had cheese and cans, some of the best cheese I think I've ever eaten. But they had the cans about this big, and so you had sacks of them and different things. And we were going over there and supposed to not get out of this area and drop this food. Well, we had a new bombardier or a navigator or something. And so what happened was we actually got lost. We never found the main dropping area. And we were down to where the trees, we had the trees kind of bent over. We were so low, we didn't want to get shot down. So we figured we'd fly low. At least they figured they'd fly low, the crew. So we get there and we see this little farmhouse out in the middle of nowhere. And so we figured, well, by golly, they looked like a bunch of people around there. So we circled, and they came out, hey, waving and everything. Well, hell, we'll drop here. Open the bomb bay and let it go. And they seemed real happy. So that was one of the missions. The other missions, we went on regular place and dropped the chow, the food.
And how did you, was it a whole group of planes that went in to drop the food?
Well, if I remember right, we were kind of separate. That's why we got lost. I don't believe we were a group. We went in trail, maybe.
And how did you know where to drop it?
Well, they had panels. Some people say they were sheets laid out on the ground. And I always got the impression it was tulips. Thank you, boys, spelled out in colored tulips on the ground. And some people said that, some people didn't. But it was, to see the pictures we have today in the museum, it's quite a shock because there's so much food we dropped. It was just, I didn't believe we could drop that much food.
It must have been satisfying to use your skills to feed people as opposed to, you know, dropping bombs. I mean,
it was in the sense that, but if I remember right, that was the time, a lot of years ago, that it was an armistice. They weren't going to shoot us down. We could drop the food and all this stuff. So really, you, even though you were really dropping food to the Dutch, you never, it wasn't like I felt sorry for them because they still had the pressure And then after I see it now, hindsight, yes, I'm very sorry. I'm glad I did it. Wonderful. Fantastic. But we still had, even though it was 1945 and it was a food drop, the war was just about over, you still had a certain amount of pressure. So it wasn't as if you just felt completely sorry for them. Afterwards, after you did it and they showed you and everything, well, of course, you understand what you were doing.
You know, you talk about the pressures of combat. I mean, you're flying these missions, there were collisions, flak, fighters. I mean, things happened.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
What was it about you and about you or your background that kept you going? Because some guys didn't. They stopped. They couldn't do it.
But yeah, that's true. It I think in a way, when I was raised in Eastern Oregon, I was grown up when I was 16. I was working. I'd go out and buck bales of hay, 60, 80 pounds, and I was most of my growing had stopped. I didn't grow hardly much as far as height goes after that. And we had a responsibility because of the family. Even though we worked outside the family, our money fed into the family, so we were actually a working team. And so I think that by realizing that when you did something, you had an end out here, it could be satisfying or not satisfying by what you put into it. So it was just something you had to do.
When you flew your 20th, your last combat mission, did you know that was going to be your last mission?
No.
Do you remember what the situation was when you finally heard it VE Day, you know, that the war in Europe was over?
It was quite interesting at Framlingham because they wouldn't let us off the base. We were restricted, and I remember there was guys were out the airplane shooting very pistols,
the flares
all over the place, you know, and machine guns up in the air. Oh, it got kind of loud that night. Some of the guys went over the fence and ended up in London, but it was quite a wild celebration.
How long was it before you were able to go home?
Oh, golly. It must have been, I don't know, I think we flew an airplane home to Loring and turned it in at Maine there. They turned it in, and I got back, and then I, on a 60-day leave, I think it was, came back. These are all trying to get time. Came back to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, going to go to B-29s. And so it had to be, the war was over when? I can't remember the days.
Yeah, in May of 45 in Europe and August 45 in Japan.
Okay, so I was in Sioux Falls, South Dakota in August, so I had to come home sometime during that span.
Any superstition about flying home? You'd survive those missions and all that, flying over all that water?
Well, I know that we got to, Gander Field, Newfoundland, and we'd landed when everybody wanted to go in and eat and clean up and everything, and I didn't want to leave that airplane. It was really weird. I think maybe I, at that time, I slept in the tail of the airplane.
Why do you think that, or what? Why do you?
Well, I finally realized it's winding down. All this is over. At least this part of my life was the wars were. Of course, I was going to go and probably B-29s, and as a gunner and go to Japan. But it for that little period of time, for about 2 or 3 days, we flew from there to Loring, Maine, and they put us Camp Miles Standish in the Army, old style Army place. Then put me on a train all the way through Fort Lewis, Washington. And that whole train trip was just, they wouldn't let us go in the mess car because we were raising too much hell. I mean, it was pretty wild. And
just blowing off steam?
Blowing off steam, and I think that was just that, whoop, the pressure coming off of us.
I think that's a thing that a lot of people don't realize about, they hear you sit here and talk about 20 missions, mm-hmm. and all. They don't understand the level of pressure and stress that's kind of constant during that period of time. I mean, Are you living with that the whole time? You know what I mean?
Well, you must be. Some people more than others. Some people had the ability, like I say, the people that actually had grown up had responsibility, which most young people in those days had. Most of them, you get 16, 17, you didn't go to college. They didn't put you through college. You leave home, you're 26. You were 16 or 17, you were out working or working your way through college, whatever it was. And I think we just grew up earlier, but we still had the pressure. It was there. And it, unfortunately, at that time, I don't believe they had too many ways to take it off of us. And most people figured that they would... by drinking, and I just never liked drinking.
Did you see other crews be shot down?
Yeah.
And I guess at that time, how do you mentally you come to terms with that, because you've got to go on the next mission? I mean, how do you?
Well, again, I was 1945. It was nothing like the people that were only going for 25 missions in the beginning. No, anywhere pressure like that. But still, when you took off and you had to form up in the clouds and you got together with all the very pistol colors going off and this group is getting with this group and you're climbing and it's getting contrails and all this stuff, anxiety level really gets high. But some people just, like our aircraft commander, the Sloan, he could just, it didn't bother because he was older. He was about 26, which was old, and when you had a commander like that, or someone your crew was older, it was easier.
Do you remember where you were, what your circumstances were when you learned that there was victory in Japan? I mean, the war was over.
Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Waiting to go to B-29 school. And so right away, bam, you had to have so many points to get out. Well, I wasn't married or anything, I was single, and no points. So they sent me, of all places, to Demi, New Mexico. And on Demi, New Mexico Air Base, they had about 5,000 to 7,000 infantry people. And I was, of course, Army Air Corps, but I really wasn't infantry. And so these were PFCs, corporals, buck sergeants, all commanding figures. They never did any work in the Army because the privates did it. It had so many privates. So they stuck me because I'd done a lot of tennis playing. I taught tennis, of all things, for something like August to December in Demi, New Mexico, until I got enough points to get out.
I've interviewed hundreds of guys in the service who got out in 45, 46. Not one has ever told me they taught tennis in the service.
Oh, It was weird.
So you got out. If you can kind of summarize for me, were you ever called up again? Was that the end of your military career?
No, it wasn't the end of the military career. I actually ended up retiring in February 1st, 1967.
And so how many years?
22 years. Oh. But I got out. I got out, went back to California. And during World War II, a lot of people forget that most of the business was in the East before World War II. They came out the coast, built all their ships, the Kaisers, the airplane playbill in California. And then the war was over when people like myself, because all of us were looking for permanent jobs. I mean, good with retirement and policemen, you know, anything but steady. Well, these companies had all gone back east, and they hadn't zoomed up for Korea yet, so that big slack period. And most of the big money went back east. And so it was awful hard for a job, so I got back in California and figured, well, I'm going to be a fireman, because I'd worked as a at nights when I was in high school, I stayed at the fire department at nights as I'd go out and fire calls, drive the trucks, whatever. During the summer, I'd burn grass, street lots, and get paid for that. And they were really nice people, had a nice dormitory room and my own area. And I figured I'd go back there, and I went back there, and they had it was just so many people, because they'd brought trainloads of people to the West. Kaiser did to build out of South Carolina. You go up above Seattle, and some of the towns up there, there are people from all from South Carolina, and they all live by each other. So it's kind of hard to find something to do. And I figured, well, I'm going to go to Oregon State University to be a forest ranger. I love the woods. I really love that. So I whacked out and went up and worked as a smoke chaser up in southeastern Washington, and where I didn't jump, but I actually walked, rode a horse. I'd go in by myself, pack in, and get all these things done. And the fire boss that we had in the district was worse than any old first sergeant I ever had. I thought, Jesus, if I've got to work with people like this, I might as well be flying. Well, I love to fly. And so after talking to the ranger's wife and the family and everything, I went back to decided, well, I'm going to go back in. I went back in as a gunner on the B-29s and then B-50s. And lo and behold, I came right to Davis-Monthan in Tucson. And many of the people, Seth McKee, Jones, a lot of these people were in SAC in these airplanes. So I ended up in B-29s, ended up going on to B-50s, and was a nuclear crew. And they wouldn't let me go to Korea, only the B-29 people. So it, as I said in the beginning, I talked about going to aviation cadets in 43 and 44, they got too many students per instructor. Well, I ended up in 1952 deciding I'm going to go back to cadets 10 years later, and I ended up getting through 53G cadet class, and it was the last aviation cadet class that was actually trained at the primary bases. You didn't have to go to I was like a Mustang in the Navy. I came up from the ranks. You didn't have to go to pre-flight at San Antonio or whatever it was down there, and they'd wash you out. They were really hard down there, and so I went through training there, and I stayed in and worked my way up, and finally ended up in B-47s, WB-47 is a hurricane hunter, and retired out of that in 1967.
So you did finally get to be a
10
pilot?
10 years.
To be a
Took
pilot.
Me 10 years, yes, sir. Huh. Yes, sir, because I love to fly, but that always drew me back.
And so once you retired, you had married at some point during this period, I guess?
Oh, yes, yes. Yeah. I'd married a girl in Georgia. A Carter, who happened to be Jimmy, Maybelle Carter, Johnny Cash, President Carter.
And the Carter.
The family. Carter. Huh. But they were cousins. And around Savannah, Georgia, down in Georgia, I married her. And it was real funny because I was never accepted as a Southerner because I wasn't from the South. And that's, they'd say, now, Roy, you don't understand. You're not a Southerner. Yet we had a political boss of Chatham County in Savannah was a Jewish man. And I thought, how can this be? But he had come in with Pulaski, Revolutionary War. They brought whole families with them and all the people, the armors and all that stuff, and they'd come in. And hell, they were Southerners, but they weren't like they'd come. There was pre-Revolutionary War. In the South, and Savannah was a lot that way. It was real funny.
And you also, did you have children also then?
No, wife got sick, had kidney problems and a transplant and finally died. Mm. And so I ended up, I was down in Savannah, Georgia, and I was a system analyst, programmer for the government, for the Army. And civil service, and growing orchids, had 5,000 orchid plants, and everything's wonderful. Going to save all your money and retire and travel. Well, she died, so I ended up coming home to Oregon. Became a ski bum at advanced age, 40 something, and mountain climbed, crest trail, tennis, fished Alaska, cooked an Alaskan troller, did all kinds of things. And I finally was interested in international skeet, which is Olympic sport. And so I tried out for that for about 32 years shooting from the shotguns I learned in the gunnery school at Las Vegas. So I ended up making the trials. I'd make the finals. The final day I'd make, but I never made the team. And I had a girlfriend, not a girlfriend, but a friend that had a friend, a girl that came up to Seattle area, which we were at that time, came up there to learn how to shoot international skeet, which is a different style. Well, she went to Switzerland in the World Games and shot over there. And with her was a girl I met with her, and 3 days later I asked her to marry me, and we got married, and we've been married ever since. So,
how many years have you been married then?
30-some-odd years. And it was amazing. I'm 81, of course, like I say now.
Do you ever think back on those years in England?
Oh, yeah.
What pops in your head? What do you reflect on now?
Well, it kind of depends on a lot. I'm not talking the war part or something like that, but a lot of things. Now I'm, for the first time in years, I'm going back to golf. And I remember some of the golf courses I went to on my bicycle, where I'd have my clubs on my bicycle. I'd ride in, old black bike, and ride into those private clubs, and they'd have a pub there, and they'd have a big beef in the fireplace and going and all that sort of thing. And I kind of related to that, but with a name like Burnham from England. And also I was an orchid grower, and also I played golf, and I was an officer in the Air Force. This gave me an open sesame to all these people. We would go over there when I was flying the B-47 and stay at Lake and Heath or Norwich, some of those Bryce Norton, some of those bases, and it was just open sesame with the name and the orchids and an officer and the golf. And so I kind of got into places that I would never have been in before.
When you look back on your time in service, were you proud of your time in service?
Oh, hell yes.
Hey, tell me why.
Well, it was my country, you know, and I was fighting for my country and what I believed in.